Hello, everybody. My name's Jesse Blanchard, and I am one of the librarians at the Rockland Public Library. Thanks for joining us tonight as we head into our Camden conference presentation for the evening. Before we do, I would like to tell you about the next couple things coming up for December. On December 10th, which is next Thursday at 6:30, we have a young man named Jeremy Grant, who is a local YouTuber who's doing a presentation called Go Discover Something Awesome in Maine. He has a series of YouTube videos that are about his favorite places in Maine that explore everything from ice fishing and moose hunting to the toboggan championships to the balloon festival. He's just really excited about exploring our state, and his YouTube channel reflects that. So we're going to be doing a talk with him. If you would like a link to that presentation, continue to email our deputy director, Patty King. Her email address is pking@rocklandmaine.gov. That's pking@rocklandmaine.gov. And you can find that information on our website and in all the press releases that we come out with. The next week after that, on December 17th, 14th, whichever the Thursday is that's after December 10th, myself and Deputy Director Patty King will be doing a presentation called Creating Calm in a Chaotic World, Stress Reduction Tips and Techniques. So we're just going to go through sort of compiled some of the things that you can do for yourself or for others that may have an even higher level of stress than normal, given what we are all living in right now. It'll include everything from mindfulness to movement to self-care, and some fun things as well. And we will also share resources for that. Also, during that week, we have little takeaway to-go kits called the Stress Less Bag that will have some fun things in it that we think could help people reduce stress. You don't have to participate or view the Zoom program to get one of those, but you can just stop by and ask for one. We'll have those until supplies last. So that is all I have for news. And right now I am going to turn everything over to Bill Bockhoffner of the Camden Conference. Thanks, Bill.
Hey, thank you, Jesse. On behalf of the Camden Conference, I'd like to welcome you to tonight's program. We extend our thanks to our host, Rockland Public Library, for making this evening's program possible. The Camden Conference is a nonprofit, nonpartisan citizens forum driven almost exclusively by volunteers from our community. The mission of the Camden Conference is to foster informed discourse on world issues. In keeping with our mission, we offer a series of community events leading up to our annual weekend conference. These three events are intended to provide background on the yearly topic and to touch on areas related to the February conference that may not be covered in its two-day format. This year's conference, our 34th, The Geopolitics of the Arctic, a Region in Peril, will take place virtually on February 20th and 21st, 2021, and will be streamed live. Please visit our website, camdenconference.org, for the conference speaker lineup and further information. Tonight, our conference community event series presenter is Dr. Susana Hancock. Originally from Maine, Susana recently moved back to the state after living in around the world, most recently in the UK, where she completed three degrees at the University of Oxford in linguistics and anthropology. Susana is a global affairs specialist in international intractable conflict and Arctic policy. Currently, Susana is a lead reviewer for the IPCC's next assessment on global climate change and is sub-chairing a study on the societal effects of the changing Arctic Ocean for UN IOC UNESCO. She is an active member of a variety of state, national, and international boards focusing on social and climate justice. In her other life, she is an elite rower who has competed around the world and qualified for the 2016 Olympic trials. Additionally, Susana serves as a member of the Camden Conference Community Events and Education Committees. Susana will be talking to us this evening about Sámi reindeer herders and music festivals in Norway, where she has lived amongst Sámi reindeer herders in northern Norway. She has also been an active member of the music scene in Norway as a concert cellist, as well as volunteering as a translator between 5 different languages at music festivals. It is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Susana Hancock.
Thank you very much, Will. I'm gonna start screen sharing. I will say that I'm sharing several videos this evening. They're all short, I promise that. If there's any issue with the technology, I have them all on backup, so we will just break the screen share for that. But start the screen share. All right, so. So yeah, thank you again, Bill, for that introduction and to everyone at the Camden Conference for having me with you today. When I was in my late teens and confused as to what I wanted to do with my life, I got an invitation to start a PhD in Tromsø, Norway. And I wasn't sure I was ready for that, but I knew after checking out a map and figuring out that Tromsø was about as far north I could go before running out of land, I knew that I was ready to go there. And so, quick trip to L.L. Bean secured me with 2 duffel bags and off I went. Over the next several years, I was largely in northern Norway, initially living in Tromsø and later in interior regions during extended fieldwork stays after I had moved to England. Much of this time I spent with Sámi reindeer herders. Over the next hour or so, technology gods willing, I'm going to offer a glimpse into the power of music for the Sámi. Once a symbol of oppression, music has been the base of Sámi cultural revitalization for the past 50 years. In recent years, music has gone from fighting for internal recognition of identity and personhood to fighting for sovereignty and language. Our journey starts in the northern regions of the Fennoscandian Peninsula, an area known here as Sápmi, that encompasses the northern extents of Norway, Sweden, Finland, and Russia. Sápmi is the homeland of Sámi, a diverse population that represents 9 or so non-mutually intelligible languages, which are further subdivided into additional dialectal varieties. While Sámi are most known as nomadic reindeer herders, this has never been a majority occupation, and only about 10% today are active in reindeer husbandry. Norway and Sweden both restrict reindeer herding to individuals of Sámi descent, whereas Finland and Russia permit anybody to participate in pastoralism. So. In popular culture, Sámi have been often represented in a mythical role and have appeared in a variety of stories from Hans Christian Andersen's The Snow Queen to Disney's Frozen, where they are known as Northuldra. For centuries, the Sámi and European Scandinavians had relatively little contact and largely ignored the presence of the other. Although the first Norwegian settlement in Finnmark, that is the northern extent, the northern part of the country, was in the 13th century, the Sámi primarily lived in the inland regions while the Europeans lived mainly in the southern regions. And when Europeans started creeping northward, they largely focused on the coast. And despite some of the sea Sámi living there, so the Sámi who are focused more on fishing and the ocean, they seem to infringe little upon each other. There were, however, issues such as changing state boundaries and extensive taxation by each state that did have direct impacts on livelihoods. Their lives had little need to intermingle really until the late 18th or to mid 19th century. At this point, Norway started to exert control up the coast into the Sámi regions and targeted Sámi with policies aimed at forced assimilation. These policies are much the same as those faced by indigenous peoples around the world, regarding them as a backward and primitive people in need of civilization. Much of this was done through education and religion, in this case, notably influenced by Lutheran pastor Lars Livy Lestadius, who effectively argued that he was indoctrinating the Sámi with Christianity to save them from lives of alcoholism and misery. Lestadius had an entrance into the community. Through his mother, he was part Sámi, he married a Sámi woman, and he spoke 2 Sámi languages. When state-mandated boarding schools were introduced, they were staffed by Lestadian personnel, which further indoctrinated the Lutheran beliefs into the local culture. Kids were prevented from speaking their native language, and they were prevented from any kind of demonstration of cultural traditions, such as music, and of religion, which, like other pagan and animism traditions, was viewed as heathenistic. I'm sure this is a familiar topic for anybody who studied anthropology or history textbooks, and it was certainly familiar around the Sápmi region, but racial biology, eugenics. At the time, there were several reasons for studying interest in racial biology. There were concerns about racial mixing, curiosities about how Sámi might relate to other populations, attempts to understand earlier migration patterns, and justifying arguments over territorial rights and policy after the Sámi and Norwegian populations began to intermix. From a colonial perspective, there was also the growing interest in proving the inferiority of the Sámi people, which further justified the savings of Christianity and the boarding schools, as well as granting the authority of the land to the Norwegian state. These black and white photographs were taken by Prince Roland Bonaparte, a relative of the French Emperor Napoleon, in 1884 as part of a series he called Les Ponts, Laplanders. His work was also grounded in contemporaneous understanding of anthropology, which was that we could establish relations between different human races based on physical characteristics, such as the skull. And by this recent headline of Renee Zellweger, who is part Sámi through her mother, can tell that racial biases are alive and well on Sámi side. So if anybody is interested in this debate, there are several films, 1999 documentary called Give Us Our Skeletons, and 2008 and 2016 films, The Katakina Rebellion and Sámi Blood. And that previous photo of the measurement of the girl's nose is a still from this latter film. In in the mid 1990s, the boarding schools were, 1900s, the boarding schools were still going strong and the Sami were facing increasing destruction of their homeland in the form of dam building, mining, and timber clearing by the Norwegian state. Perhaps the most threatening was the planned damming of the Alta River, a major waterway that both supported their fishing economy and would also result in the flooding of reindeer herding lands. This opposition resulted in a decade-long conflict consisting of violent and non-violent demonstrations throughout the country. Because of the need to come together in face of this big opposition, Sami leaders influenced the creation and reinforcement of various cultural symbols of Sami culture. One of these was the joik. The joik is one of the oldest continuous musical traditions in Europe, although its exact history remains unknown. During the period of Christianization of the Sami, joiking was associated with religion, and thus it was condemned as sinful and punishable if heard in schools. For many, it was consequently devalued. Despite the suppression, however, joiking managed to survive and it emerged as a stalwart of tradition. And in the face of external threats, joiking grew as a marker of sin into a marker of pride. So just one of this slide here, got up in the upper left, where it says Koford Kommune in Norwegian. This is a town that's just northeast, I guess, of Tromsø, and a sign that they've put to welcome everybody into the town. And that part of Norway has two official languages, Norwegian and Northern Sami. And the Northern Sami is top, and they have not been able to keep that sign with both languages intact. It keeps the Sami part keeps getting shot out. So those are a bunch of different bullet holes that just obliterate the writing. Below that says, we're hunger striking. And so this is a hunger strike in 1979. That was the culmination of the river damming demonstration. So Sami who went in front of the parliament in Oslo. Bottom on the right is demonstration at the river, and Elva skal leve, it says the river shall live, and then we'll fight on. Above that, the chains are, and the top image are of people putting themselves in the front of the destruction, and the center is just, we came first and we won't leave. So this is these are Matahete and Sverre Hjelsberg holding what appears to be reindeer jerky at that 1979 hunger strike in Oslo. While there, 20-year-old Matahete, who's the one on the left, performed a joik. Together with Sverre Hjelsberg, this joik became the chorus to a song that was inspired by the protest called Sami Eidan, which the two took to the following year's Eurovision Song Contest. Eurovision is a music contest between European nations and a few additional global invitees to fight for the best song of the year. The lyrics of Sami Eidan, which translates to Sami Earth, were performed in Norwegian with addition to the joik as the chorus. The song described the Sami quest for autonomy, likening the Sami to a puff of wind from the north, which turned into a storm. It talks about joik being stronger than any weapon because joik has neither a beginning nor an end, and how it was heard throughout the hunger strike. Although the song ultimately placed 15th in the contest, the wide audience of Eurovision meant that the song was amongst the first instances of Sami influence on the wider culture of Europe. And indeed, it helped the world see some of the issues facing land and identity rights in Norway. Today, there's even a British football club, Accrington Stanley from Lancashire, that has adopted this joik as its team song today. And a version of it appears in the 2011 thriller film, The Thing. One reason that injustices toward Sami populations were not on a wider radar at the time was that the Sami were not actually recognized as an indigenous population until 1975. Even by 1979, during the time of the Alta Dam controversy in the Oslo demonstration, Norway was still a decade away itself from recognizing the Sami as a native population with inherent rights. In 1975, joik played a defining moment for Sami recognition. when singer, poet, and artist Niels Oslak Valkeapää, known as Alawash, was part of a group traveling to the World Council of Indigenous Peoples, where through his demonstration of music and joik, the Sámi were first initiated and welcomed into the global community of Indigenous people. 2 decades later, Valkeapää used joik as a demonstration of culture at the 1994 Olympic opening ceremonies in Lillehammer. What follows is a short clip of this performance. I'm sorry, it's not terribly good footage, but it does capture the idea that in the 1990s, the Sámi were still seen by the Norwegian government as sort of infantile and romanticized bygone relics. Indeed, other Sámi performers had turned down the opportunity to perform, fearing that it was tokenizing their culture and bereft of any significance. So I'll just play this.
Photography teachers probably refer to them as Lapps, but they do prefer to be called Sámis.
They are very similar to Native Americans of the United States, and they date back more than 8,000 years. They're spread across the northern regions of Norway and Sweden and Finland and Russia. Niels Oslak Valkeapää is now performing a joik, which is an ancient rhythmic chant or poetic song of the Sámi people. Valkeapää lives in Finnmark, which is the northernmost county in Norway, and the Sámi people rely very much on the reindeer as the staple of the Sámi household.
The sound of the joik is supposed to keep the reindeer herd quiet, and we are definitely hoping that that is the case today. Well, they're used to being out in the woods, and what they've done here is that they've placed Sámis at each of the exits of the arena just in case one does decide to head for the woods. They'll wrestle them down.
There are some of the Sámis guarding the exits, and in case the reindeer do get a little out of control, they seem to be a little better now than they were earlier this week.
I think that's hazardous duty pay those guys get.
So, while Alois's performance at this event at the Lillehammer Olympics might have been tokenizing, joik was part of a growing tradition centered around cultural revival, that of music festivals. This first festival, Davi Shuva, took place just after the 1979 hunger strike, and it drew Indigenous people from around the world, as well as many from throughout Sápmi. Festivals have been a significant force in the reestablishment and reinforcement of Sámi identity because they enable and indeed necessitate joik and other inherited cultural performances to be freely expressed in communal spaces rather than hidden away from proselytizing ears. The early festivals, like Davi Shuva, had turned acts of dissent into acts of growth, and most importantly, were doing so in supportive and public environments. This here is a picture of Gwagdavjadno Kautokeino, which is the site of a now annual festival known as the Sámi Easter Festival. It's also the site on the globe map that at the beginning was the site mark there. In general, the Easter Festival is a week-long opportunity for Sámi to come together just before the spring reindeer migration from the winter grounds on the coast to the summer feeding grounds. However, while in Kautokeino during this week, they also have weddings, confirmations, and christenings, as many of the Sámi are still practicing Lutherans. They also make arrangements for the migrations, they hold meetings, and they visit with people with whom they otherwise might not see. And most importantly, they celebrate culture. Some of the prime events involve things such as lasso throwing competitions, reindeer racing, prizes on offer for costume, as well as for speed, snowmobile racing, art shows, storytelling, and tens of concerts. So several years ago, while at the Easter Festival, I oversaw the recording of the main concert stage for the Norwegian national media. Sámi musicians from around Sápmi, and indeed those living elsewhere in the world, came to perform. Every type of music from hip hop and bluegrass to folk and rock and joik was featured. One of my main tasks was to film what's called the Sámi Grand Prix. The Grand Prix is an annual competition for the best song there, and the winner goes on to compete at a Europe-wide contest known as Lea International, which celebrates songs of minority languages. Like most of those big television or in-person talent song shows, people in the audience can vote at the Grand Prix by texting in their votes, and the person with the most votes at the end is declared the winner and is sent to elsewhere in Europe to compete. There have been a handful of wins in this European event from performers at this Sámi event. The Grand Prix has two contests. There's categories. There's a song and traditional joik. Joiking is different than other forms of singing, not just stylistically, which I will demonstrate in a few minutes. Not me personally, but in terms of meaning. One doesn't necessarily joik about something, but rather one joiks something. You can think of this as evoking something rather than describing it. So this means that joiks are deeply personal, like a name, and they're often given as gifts to others. They can share stories, they can be sources of cooperation or competition. One extensive study on joik describes it as an art of recollection. You know, when you joik, you recall to mind something that you have experienced. It's not a question of something that you have learned by heart or mechanically, but you're associated emotionally, often strongly and intensively, about what you joik about. Although traditionally joiks are a cappella, since the 1980s, musicians have experimented with mixing joik in other genres. And again, I will talk about that shortly. In recent years, joik has transitioned from inward expression of self-autonomy and self-identity to outward expressions, notably against climate destruction. The Scandinavian peninsula is well known for its oil and gas fields. Indeed, Norway cites its oil wealth as one reason that it rejects joining the EU outright. Globally, Norway is one of the top seven exporters of crude oil, and oil comprised 62% of the country's exports last year. Much of its natural resources, however, are located in Sápmi, just like the hydroelectric plant project on the Alta River that instigated the hunger strike in 1979. The Sámi argue that oil mining, tree clearing, and the associated pollution and infrastructure devastate their subsistence economy. In addition to oil and gas fields, this map on the left, center left, shows the known location of 524 contaminated sites above the Arctic Circle in Norway that have been identified as being toxic to surrounding areas. Mostly they're polluted with heavy metals and hydrocarbons from mining, but a lot are also just decades of treating the Arctic as a general wasteland. Although this map shows just Norway, the levels of pollution are similar for Sweden, Finland, and Russia. And some of this pollution is from elsewhere. When Chernobyl exploded in 1986, radioactive cesium seeped into the land in Sápmi and directly led to the slaughter of 73,000 reindeer in Sweden, northern Sweden alone, which was a third of the country's population because they had consumed radioactive lichen. So for reference, this is the location of Kautokeino. It's marked. Municipality. On the right map, upper right, you can see current mining sites or areas of interest for mining in the north. Mostly mining for nickel, iron, precious metals, cobalt. And this is all reindeer territory. And reindeer husbandry and mining are not a compatible combination. This has been a source of continual fights between the Sámi and the Sámi's interests and the state's financial interests. The interests of the state are usually purchased by out-of-country companies with no money going toward communities in the areas of the mining.
I show this slide primarily to people in the UK and Ireland, because one of the big major questions I get is, what are the local people going to go ahead and say about this project? And I show them this picture and I say, what local people?
So this is Gullock, and that was Clive Sinclair Poulton, the then CEO of Beowulf Mining, proposing several mines in this reindeer herding area, and he's proposing them to shareholders. Beowulf is a British company that purchased the rights to mine Gullock in 2006. As you might assume from his statement in the video, this deal was brokered between the state and the company. No one representing reindeer herding or anybody living in this area was part of the agreement or any of the discussions. Special concerns rose regarding Gawk as well, because the mine would experiment combining hydropower with tailings dams in the same system, which poses significant risks and with not just heavy toxins and explosives downstream, including the feeds to several cities. The pollution also extends to the air nearby soils, which the reindeer eat and therefore become unfit for human consumption. So most concerning is that any profit doesn't go to the local population. Gawk, however, holds more than 600 million tons of iron in a single deposit. And while it was on hold for the past 6 years, mainly due to protests by Sámi herders, its permits for active mining were again auctioned last July. So it's gonna be starting up shortly. This next video is a joik by a young woman, Maxita Marak, protesting Beowulf's acquisition of the Gawk mines. So this is the nearby city of Kiruna, which is on the border of Sweden and Norway. And it's home to the world's largest and richest bodies of iron ore in the world. It daily produces enough iron ore pellets to construct 6 Eiffel Towers. This area has been inhabited for the last 6,000 years, and the presence of iron in the mountain has been known to the Sámi for at least since at least the 1600s. When the Kiruna mine opened in 1898, it opened in 1898 and has since been in operation for the past 122 years. And you can see here, this town is 25,000 people and they're all, this is the town here. So it's right at the mine. And the cut in the mountain is at a 65 degree angle and it's cutting underneath the town. So looking at this, the town is situated here. And over the years, they've just gradually involved the mining and down. And they have signs that the iron is still, they keep discovering it lower and lower, which means that the cut is going to gradually get deeper and deeper, still at that angle. Problem with this is that it's destabilizing the land. And in 2004, after a century of mining, the land had become so destabilized underneath the town that much of the town started to sink and they decided it needed to be relocated. In a process that's currently ongoing now. It is expected to need to move again as the iron is continually located deeper and the cut continues to undermine the town. Last May, mining activity here triggered a 4.9 earthquake in the mine's footwall. It was Sweden's largest mine-related earthquake ever, and possibly its largest of any sort. here you can see some of the effort involved in moving some of the town structures. Some of the buildings have needed to be moved in parts or dismantled completely and reconstructed elsewhere. Unlike the British Beowulf Company, however, the Kiruna mine is owned wholly by the Swedish state. And while some of the locals are employed, most came to work at the mine itself, which owns its own infrastructure. Therefore, much of the income generated by the mine doesn't stay in the community. And even many of the costs associated with moving the town because of the mining activity were passed on to the inhabitants. It isn't just the active mines, though, that are an issue. And in a break from music, this is a photo of a curtain of 400 bullet-holed reindeer skulls hanging in front of the Norwegian Parliament in a protest over land rights. This is known as Pile of Sápmi, and it's part of a mobile installation by Mari Anasara, who lives in Kautokeino. When she tried to address the parliament with her on installation, only two parliamentary members showed up to talk with her and listen to what she had to say. Sara is from a reindeer herding family, and twice a year, her family travels with their herds from Kautokeino to the island of Kvalia, which is just west of the city of Tromsø, a journey that takes them several weeks. Several years ago, Sara's younger brother, who now has a herd of his own, was informed that he would need to cull his herd down to a maximum of 75 animals. Norway argued that the herding community has too many animals and that they were destroying the land's prospects for mining. At the same time, the large herds cannot continue without extensive land. And so this issue of land use was indeed a mutual problem. Killing the reindeer with bullets to the skull has never been, and still isn't today, a standard method of slaughtering animals for Sámi. And this is because, like many people who rely on all parts of the animal for subsistence, for food, clothing, commercial profit, the bullet doesn't do this. Instead, it's done by slitting the neck. However, these bullet holes are further symbolic to the perceived disrespect to the community by not even valuing the dead animals and their offerings. This next picture is a little bit more graphic, so here's your warning if that's not your thing, but it is less graphic than it almost was. So Sara's brother took the state to court to challenge the requested cull of his animals. And she, when that court case didn't look like it was going very well, she brought 200 freshly slaughtered reindeer heads to the court, topped with a Norwegian flag. Norway, like the US and many countries and other places, see that planting of a flag as claiming a stake, a concept that doesn't exist in the Sámi culture. In this way, despite initial victories, her brother's case progressed to the headlines in the New York Times and has been heard at the UN, but however, without much success. This call demanded by the Norwegian government has created a rivalry and distrust between herding families. As there developed a competition to slaughter reindeer from the other families' herds to meet the state demands in order to sustain one's own livelihood. This has contributed to tensions as herding is generally a community effort that requires extensive collaboration. If Sara's brother, for instance, meets the full needs of the state on him, and the state has requested, he's not the only one who's been asked to do this, but if he continues with only 75 animals, his annual income would be slashed to being about $3,500. And I don't know how many of you have been to Norway, and especially to the interior in the Arctic, but $3,500 doesn't get one very far, especially when you remember these people are semi-nomadic and often have at least two homes as a result. He, like other herders, are in need of new careers if this is the direction in which they are going. Okay, back to cute fuzzy photos. There's no doubt that reindeer herding and mining struggle to exist or to coexist. The question about who has the right to the land, when it's at the detriment to the other, who has the power of self-determination and autonomy? It wasn't until 2007 that Norway even recognized Sámi sitas. A sita is a sort of a pastoral region, sort of like a municipality, but much, much bigger. That they even recognized that these divisions existed. Previously, they were just dividing, the state was just dividing Sámi into towns as the state felt it needed to do. Mining and conflicting areas of land use, however, aren't the only issue. Climate change is also taking its toll, especially on the land's ability to support the reindeer. One way is that it impacts the ability of reindeer herders to complete their annual migration between the feeding and calving grounds. As I was saying earlier, this is a journey that can take several weeks. One of my friends, for instance, lost several hundred reindeer when they fell through a frozen river and all of the animals drowned. Routes have changed, which takes more time, fuel, and food. So most people now accompany the animals on snowmobile. So going around rivers, going longer routes is quite a lot more fuel. Warming weather also means that the weather patterns are less predictable. There's rain in January or snow in June. Sometimes the snow is too deep and the snowmobiles and animals can get stuck. Ideally, calves are born just after the spring migration, but they can be born en route or while still in the winter feeding area if snow patterns prevent travel when expected. This can cause mothers to abandon their babies and can make young calves significantly more vulnerable, both to predation and the difficulties of traveling. There have also been new storms that have killed hundreds of animals at once, and bacteria growing in warming waters that prevents fishing as an additional source of food, pastime, and income. Reindeer eat lichen, which grows in the winter underneath the deep snow. However, if the weather is too warm and either the snow is too wet or there's rain, the lichen becomes trapped in a thick layer of ice and the animals starve to death as they cannot get supplementary food. Reindeer herds and sápmi aren't like herds of cattle here, where they're in corrals or closed pastures. They're effectively free range, and different herds can intermingle. They're marked by their owner's sort of mark in their ear, notches in their ear. But this makes it hard for herders to get food to each animal because they don't always know where they are. But you can see the man on the left here is throwing some food to his animals. Snow also buffers and protects the lichen from being trampled, which stunts its growth for future seasons. Without sufficient snow cover, reindeer fall victim to the predatory wolves more easily. They can neither hear them coming nor find tracks. In the upper right, you see Joanna Itzi digging through the snow, or digging through the ice to access the lichen because his reindeer can't get through that ice. You can imagine doing that for thousands of animals. And you can think of how much lichen a reindeer can eat. So doing it for all of your animals every day. In the lower left, Daniel Vicklund watches his reindeer by drone, and the conditions don't allow him to follow by snowmobile. He can even play sounds of dogs barking to direct his herd as he needs. Since much of Sami tradition, culture, and knowledge have all developed within the ecosystem, this rapid climate change doesn't just impact the ability to generate a living for these communities, but it also drastically alters the diet, lifestyle, identity, and even other aspects, such as language. This next video clip is from Sofia Janak's Api, which addresses the still taboo topic of mental health and suicide among Sami herders. One third of all reindeer herders, it's estimated, have attempted or contemplated suicide, largely because they're unable to make a living, which has the catastrophic effects on their self-worth and identity. In the last video clip from Maxita Marek, who yoiked about land destruction from the British Mining Company, Janak also focuses on loss. For her, it isn't just related to mining or oppressive state policies, but it's about how these losses contribute to the loss of identity, which is the huge driver of the disproportionate suicide rates in this area. And unlike Marek, however, who targets the global audience through the Sami-specific genre of joik, this piece targets the Sami community itself. Sung in Sami, a translation to English, doesn't directly address suicide. In fact, the lyrics compare people to seemingly endless oceans. The meaning of the community's suicide crisis is only evident through understanding the cultural symbolism inherent in the language. In that sense, she's taking the experiences of the outside world, the mining, the fights, the damming of rivers, climate change, and funneling them into metaphors that only her community can understand. In this sense, she's able to make a public performance out of a very personal topic that can only be understood by the same community experiencing it. outsiders don't understand what's going on. They don't understand the impacts. And by selecting to sing about it in an abstract way, that's exactly the point she makes. One, however, doesn't need to understand her words to understand the theme when paired with this short video.
Whole months coming happy, so
So I just wanted to compare that with the previous one where the music is targeting these different audiences in the community and it's, you know, fighting for identity, both looking internally and externally. And I want now to return to that joik that accompanied the song with the drone footage of reindeer at the beginning. And that was a joik by Mary Boine, who only began joiking once she was in college, as a way to learn about her cultural heritage, as prior to that it had been marked as satanic by her parents, Lutheran parents. Boine's songs were strongly rooted in her experiences of being what she initially perceived as a shameful and discarded minority. Gula gula, she says, listen, listen. Why do you pollute the earth, she asks. If we take its life, we're killing ourselves. It's all too easy to ignore the damage that the reindeer herders are doing to land themselves in focusing on the damage from the external companies chasing profit. As economic challenges increase and as their way of life becomes more challenging, the Sami are also prioritizing profit at a cost to the same planet that sustains them. They're relying on snowmobiles and technology, for instance, to complete migrations that have previously been done on foot. And so Boine as a musician is at targeting her audience. While here, she has a message that's only directed to the Sami speaking community. Notably, she does this often through code switching. That is, she swaps between Sami English and Norwegian in her songs to change the audience, which effectively changes her message, changes the audience, enables her to have multiple conversations at the same time with different groups of people in the same song. By and large, and I will discuss an exception in a moment, joik has become not just a source of Sami pride, but now of Scandinavian pride. This next minute is a clip of Jon Henrik Fjellgren's audition to Stalingsfriga in 2014, which is Sweden's version of America's Got Talent. He ended up with standing ovations and winning the entire year's event as the best performance in the country. Despite joik's increased acceptance outside Sápmi, interestingly enough, it isn't really fully accepted within yet. Remember how I was saying that it was banned by the Lestadian Christianity community as hedonistic? Well, a couple years ago at a trumpet concert, internationally known trumpeter Ole Edvard Antonsen joiked a few lines during a free concert held at the church in Kautokeino, which is sponsored by the local hotel. And the community immediately shut him down and became outraged. How dare he call the devil directly in church in the middle of a concert? Consequently, there was a brief moment to movement to ban everything not directly related to Lutheran worship in the church to prevent further sacrilegious acts. This joik that I'm gonna share in a moment is a personal one, rather than being about the land or environment. And it evokes his friend Daniel, who died of diabetes, and the prize money that Don Henrik won went to establish a diabetes foundation in his friend's memory. So despite the lack of English or Swedish for the audience in the song, and that I have edited out many of the parts of the camera panning around the audience for the sake of brevity, you can still tell how much emotion is received by the judges, none of whom are Sami themselves. This piece was included in Sweden's 2026 bid to host the Winter Olympic Games as part of something that best represents their culture. So this next example of a modern joik I want to share is a more uplifting one. This is Adrian Angelico, who's a Norwegian Sámi opera singer. And here he is joiking his sister Pernilla, as I was talking earlier about not joiking about something, but actually that thing itself. So this is his tribute to his sister, who despite troubles of her own has stood steadfastly by him through his. And he's merged the joik with traditional opera singing, which I wanted to share so you can see the difference in types of sound production. Opera and joik being produced very differently within the body. This one is also fun for me because I've actually played with most of the people in this orchestra, as it's a combination of orchestra in Tromsø where I played for a year. And joikers often perform until they run out of breath. You breathe, start singing again. There's little care to specific phrasing that we talk about in music here. And likewise, joiks aren't necessarily static. There's no right or wrong. They can change. Performers aren't judged by whether they get the vocalics or the pitches exactly right, so to say, but about how well they evoke their subjects. And these are some of the musical features with which performers need to reckon when they combine joik and non-joik forms of art. So if you're joiking something but performing with people, that communication needs to happen, so. Sorry about that. Although joik has been the form of music that really triggered the revitalization of culture, the Sámi are largely no longer trying to justify their existence to the Scandinavian states, but to justify their existence to themselves and to negotiate their place in the globalizing world. They've only been recognized within Norway as having inherent rights and autonomy for the past 30 years, and the legacy of language and culture loss and shame associated with 200 years of forced assimilation policies, Norwegianization, and Lestadianism are alive and well. The same music that sought to justify their indigeneity to the world has now become a tool to justify the value to themselves. In this last part of my presentation, I'm just going to talk briefly about rap and hip hop. As with many youth around the world, hip hop and rap have captured the souls of many young Sámi. Joik metal began in the 1900s and ventures into rap began, 1990s. And ventures into rap and began shortly thereafter. Rap has been used particularly for several reasons. One is it's considered youthful, modern, norm-breaking, and urban, sort of anything that reindeer herding isn't. Many younger Sámi who dream of moving to the big city and seeing the world would rather learn to rap than to joik. Sámi rap is about the same global topics as rap anywhere: drugs, violence, sex, oppression, searching for acceptance, you name it. This group, Dualava Duatar, which means dirty tundra, first intrigued me about the role that at what at first might be dismissed as global grunge has within the community, especially looking towards its future. I first met Fred, who's the one in the bandana on the lower images and the shaved head on the top, about 12 years ago when we were living near each other. I knew nothing about rap at the time, but I was intrigued by the cultural blending. In what world is he living when he puts on his gakdi, so that's the blue and red top, but then combines it with jeans, Adidas, leather pants, bandanas, when the language he uses doesn't even have the vocabulary for the topic about which he sings? Who is he? That same year, my questions were also challenged on the national level as the group entered Norske Talenter, which is Norway's version of America's Got Talent, in 2008. Unlike Jon Henrik, who was welcomed as a Swedish icon when he took the stage a few years later, this group's belonging was questioned. Who were these guys from the north? And while it was the first time many people had heard rap in Sámi before, and they were impressed by their MC talent, many were also confused. One of the judges bitterly complained, saying that the group cannot possibly represent Norway, if they don't perform in an intelligible language. This gave the group a conundrum. Are they Norwegian? Are they Sámi? Can one be Sámi without being Norwegian? What are the politics of identity? In the end, they returned to the finals to perform their rap in Sámi, but this time they included a chorus in Norwegian. However, the texts were completely different, as if directed to two completely different cultures and audiences, as indeed they were. Here I'll play a quick 15-second clip. You can hear after about 10 seconds the swap in language and sound quality. It, however, gave the Norwegian judges the feel-good content that they wanted and advanced the finals, winning the judges' award from their semifinal. So music, for this reason, the code switching and identity politics have enabled music and other forms to serve as platforms for identity expression and negotiation, to look at questions: who belongs, who's an insider, who isn't. So that Norwegian line right at the end was just, you know, if you take the way, the road, the way far north road, you come to the place where Sámi live. And then it's about how you don't understand anything that goes on. But rap isn't just about teenage angst, where it might be associated with in this country. For some young Sámi, rap is about preservation. Slynn Craze, pictured here, began rapping when he was 14 and now tours the world to inspire young people to be proud of their cultural heritage. Amok, another rap artist, performs in the Nari Sami language, another Sami language with approximately 300 speakers. Amok, whose father is the president of the Inari Sami Language Association, often finds that he needs to create new words for topics about which he performs. Providing new vocabulary also enables the discussion of new global issues within the community and is helping Inari maintain a 21st century vocabulary. Part of this linguistic update helps Amok encourage younger Sami to learn the language rather than to reject it as antiquated. He and other rappers have been using rap as a foundation of so-called language nests, a form of youth primary school education that is focused on language and is most known for the successful revitalization of Māori in New Zealand. Thanks to such efforts, kids now, whether Sami or not, can attend primary, secondary, and tertiary education in Sami if they so choose. Speaking Sami at home or having a parent or grandparent who does is one of the state's criteria for Sami identity and part of the Norwegian Sámi Act of 1990, which is part of the state's laws to combat the previous Norwegianization policies. And while there's no overall census to know the number of people identifying Sami in the world, the estimate is just over maybe 80,000, only one third of whom speak one of the languages. And again, you remember that there are 9 different languages. Not all of them have orthography. Dividing 80,000 gets down to very few numbers very quickly. Sami languages are Finno-Ugric, which means that they're a completely different family than languages like English, Norwegian, or Swedish. And more related to languages like Finnish, Hungarian, and Estonian. These languages are highly inflective, and the root form of the word changes with the syntax. This means, unlike English, where we really focus on end rhymes, Sami languages can have fun patterns like internal rhyming, which can make them great natural rapping languages. So some Sami youth now want to learn their own languages just to be able to rap. These performers aren't just staying within the Fennoscandian Peninsula, however, but they're traveling all over the world to share their culture and language. And again, reframing what it means to be a young Sami. It's owning a culture in a way that turns any idea of backwardness and a shame on its head. So while Sami was considered controversial just 12 years ago, when Dulva Dotar entered the Norway's Got Talent event, but 6 years ago when Jan Henrik won the event in Sweden, and last year, Fred, who's the rapper from before, he joined up with another band known as Kano, which is short from his hometown of Kautokeino, so, and they qualified to represent Norway at the 2019 Eurovision Song Contest. There, they performed a piece called Spirit in the Sky, which is based on a Sami legend and included joik. At Eurovision, they finished 6th overall, although they did win the overall audience vote. Both this and Jan Henrik's win in 2014 demonstrate how Sami music has gained currency as a widely accepted and contemporary genre, and with that, the Sami culture has as well. And their successes among non-Sami audiences are as honest representations of their nations, not like the tokens of Niels Aslak Valkeapää's performance at the 1994 Olympics. But instead, yeah, they're the more accepted as the sort of the honest representations of their nations as seen from both inside and outside. So what I'm going to share now is one last clip from a performance of Spirit in the Sky. No, this is before or after Eurovision, but it's back in Norway at an event known as Allsang på Grensen. And the song is sung in English, which is common for many Eurovision entrants.
Can't you stay with me to the night?
Sing my spirit. Lost in the night, the violent light shape took away my life.
Ooh,
So with that, I'll say gitu, which means thank you, and stop there. Keep photo of reindeer. Thank you.
Thank you, Susana. If anybody has any questions, you can put them in the chat. And if Susana can't see them, I can read them to you. And now I'm blocking you with my chat. I just have a quick question for you. I don't know if this isn't maybe too deep into anything. Since it looked like there were definitely a history of struggles between Norwegians and the Sami people, and now that they seem to be maybe a little bit more accepted through that music, I'm wondering if there's any kind of issues with like cultural appropriation by Norwegians of the Sami culture.
Yes and no. There is, but it seems to be much more, I guess, for two things. One, for tourism, yes. I guess there's a big thing of, you know, come to Norway, see the Northern Lights, and, you know, go have a reindeer ride. And there are a lot of people who sort of are monetizing that. Come spend a night in a lavo, which is sort of like a teepee, or try bidos, which is a traditional soup or something like that, where either of those people aren't, and they're dressing up as if they're Sami, acting like some of them are, some of them aren't. So from the tourism side, definitely. But outside of that, I'm not really sure there is much. It seems to be really, really respectful.
Good. Thank you.
Question from Kim about prospects for cultural survival. So one area, I think, on the language side has been looking a bit dire, especially when thinking that there's only maybe 30,000 people in the world who speak all of these languages, 9 different languages combined, some of which cannot be written down because they don't have an alphabet, don't have a literary language. But now with the support of speakers, and in that one language, Inari Sami, that only has 300 speakers, I have the ability that now they have schooling, which 10 years ago they didn't have. And so using music has really been a big part of that in generating that interest. But it's also about the interest, and that people now see that there's the capacity to use this language for something other than reindeer herding. So from that side, it's looking better. There are a lot of activities that they've developed, both events and this whole, where I was in the north, there's a whole national, a whole week of sort of celebration, but sort of support of the culture that is in the cities. Actually, I believe it's a national event in the cities for a week about looking at sort of, and also talking about questions of appropriation and who, what are the rights that, but it focuses a lot on preservation. So I think, I guess, lifestyles, I guess, are threatened everywhere around the world, but I think there's a lot of incentive in the past 30 years or so to really look at preservation of culture. So I guess prospects are better now than they have been, but a lot of that is language and culture. I don't know if that's like really an answer. Laws about reindeer herding changing. Yes, I don't know too much about those right now, but there's a reindeer herders association that's constantly lobbying in parliament and is a political body that's looking at laws and how they affect different aspects of the state. So that's certainly parts of this. I don't know too much about what the herd laws changing, except that I know the state is requesting that the number of animals is continually cut down, which is impacting the viability of that being a lifestyle, but it's that it is being debated in parliament. And there's not only there's the national Norwegian national parliament, but there's a separate Sami parliament as well. So they have their own body that they discuss. On that topic, Bill has a question about the usual side of a sustainable herd. Some of them have several thousand animals, some are several hundred. So the more prestigious herds are several thousand, and people do have more authority the more animals they have, but several hundred is usually sort of a minimum of what one needs to make a life out of it. Obviously music as a cultural heritage, are there obvious standards in how they pass their history through music? I'm not entirely certain I understand Jane's question. Are there obvious standards? The music is very much, I don't know how to answer that. Jane, you can help me out if you'd like.
Okay.
Yes.
Susana, hi.
Hi.
What I'm trying to get at is when I think of a lot of indigenous cultures, they have musical, literally standards that are used to project different historical periods or cultural highlights in so they pass them on from generation to generation. But you've spoken about this music as being so very individual, not as a story, but as what is felt to evoke, a particular time. So how do they use a standard that may pass through to teach this as a cultural, classic, or, there's no such, I don't know, is there such a thing? How would they teach this?
Yeah, there isn't quite the same concept of history through music. And as I did say, music, the success of one's ability as a musician is much more judged on the emotions that are generated rather than what is felt rather than what is actually communicated necessarily in sort of a very strict sense. But that said, they certainly use joik as mapping. If you're going on reindeer migrations, and you've got 2 weeks, and you have to get from point A to point B, and you don't have your GPS or a map, and it's open tundra. I mean, they can use joik in language. If you think of, we say that certain languages have thousands of words for snow. I mean, these are some of those languages where you have different words and different ideas for different things that you experience. So you can map away from, your winter grounds to your summer grounds by evoking certain emotions or certain topics. And that will tell you if you were in with the culture, how to go, so that you can successfully make your journey by knowing at what point are you thinking about certain things. So there is certainly a knowledge that comes with the music, but it's not directly the same as learning specific standards necessarily. I don't know if that really answers your question.
Susana, that's wonderful to think about. That is a completely different way to view.
Yeah.
The music passes on, but so they must do a lot of cultural heritage through storytelling or some other.
Yeah, lots of storytelling.
Okay, thank you.
And the music isn't so much about, I guess it's just different, you're conveying different parts of the history and different parts of the story.
Now, I understand that. Thank you very much for explaining the
Jane.
Fine points here. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Wayne's question about Sami appearing to be racially indistinguishable from other Scandinavians. Is this the view in Sweden? How has this affected their identity issues? Very, very true. I mean, one of the big issues they had initially arguing that they were an indigenous population, people saying that how are you an indigenous population when you look like you could be anybody that we associate with Norwegian and Sweden, Norway and Sweden, any of the northern Scandinavian areas. So that was exactly true. And when actually in 1975, when they first went to the World Council of Indigenous Peoples, there was somebody from South America who's basically like, so you're basically saying you're white Indians, is that blonde white Indians, is that what you're arguing? So that's what that's how they were seen by the greater Indigenous community as well. But by showing that they had, you know, thousands of years of belonging to that one place, they were, and there's very specific traditions and culture, they were able to sort of set themselves apart. But definitely the fact that they look like they could be anybody, largely from Sweden, Norway, was certainly problematic for them. I don't know that there are any other questions. Happy to.
Looks like that might be the end of the questions.
I will just say that was one of the issues with, you know, skull measurements initially, was also, you know, trying to distinguish. You can't do it necessarily on skin color, although some Sami do have darker skin, but generally you're not doing it on skin color. So it's, you know, how can we prove that one people, you know, is superior to another, etc. Yes, are Sami assisted by grants or other financial help in the industries that utilize the resources? 1990 in the Komi semi-autonomous in Russia, they got assisted by, yes. There are certain grants and sort of parts of the state government as well that are even supposed to give certain resources towards language and cultural revitalization efforts. And financial help indeed as well about, but that's gone both ways really in the past since 1990 with the Sami Act in Norway. They've gotten that financial assistance. Prior to that, it was sort of the reverse where it was, you had Norway, Sweden, Finland, and Russia, and all of their state borders have changed. Norway is part of Sweden and Denmark, and Finland was part of Russia and all of that. So it wasn't just necessarily those four countries, but three out of the four anyway, it's a pattern. Would, you know, tax Sami and say, okay, if you're herding reindeer and your winter feeding grounds are in Russia and your summer grounds are in Norway, then we get to tax you from all three states. So for quite a while, that was the approach. Is that how can we make money off of them? And they didn't have the money to give, so they'd have give other things, reindeer, et cetera. But since especially the 1990s, there have been the efforts from the state government for revitalization as well.
Excellent, thank you. Thank you so much, Susana. Oh, we got one, we'll take this one last question here from Karen, if that's okay with you.
And differences between Russia and Scandinavia. Certainly Finland, Norway, and Sweden have a very similar approach in that they both treat, especially when looking at reindeer herding, they both treat that as an activity that is only to be done by Sami, which is partly about the preservation of land as well and access. And Finland and Russia enable anybody who wants to herd reindeer to herd reindeer. And it's a fairly common activity for people who are non-Sami as well. And Russia, so I guess Norway and Sweden are quite similar. And then you have Norway, Sweden, and Finland that are all sort of maybe a little bit more invested in Sami preservation. And Russia's kind of that outsider. I don't know too much about Russia specifically in that respect, except it is part of an overall topic in Russia about who is indigenous and what does it mean to be indigenous versus minority population. And that is an absolute massive topic in Russian politics today, about state funding and who gets what resources and what help from the state and whether one gets help or resources from the state. And so it fits within that. And I don't know specifically how that's treated, but it's with respect to the Sámi, except that it is a very highly political and contentious issue. So not quite sure that helps. And then Bill Bachner asking whether I have a joik myself. I don't, but I have performed a few with some friends. So I had a friend who is a lawyer in Norway, and he was giving a, he and I were doing a joik, and he was all excited because I was going to be going to the US afterward. He loves the US because his favorite city in the whole world is in the US, and he called that New York City. So I don't have my own, except he tried to blend me into New York City somehow. So.
Great. Well, I think that's about it. Thank you so much, Susana. Thank you, Bill, and the Camden Conference for letting us host you and be a part of your program. I thought that was really cool. I could probably go on about wanting to hear more about some of that metal music that you were talking about, but I can save that for another time. That was pretty fascinating. Thank you so much, and everybody have a really great night.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you.